Well, good morning and welcome to worship this morning. We are a people that's gathered around the good news of God that Christ brought, that says that God loves this world, and that even what we're going through right now in this pandemic time, with all of the potential uncertainty about when we may resume life or whatever the new normal might look like, that even during this time we are secure in God's loving hands. And so we gather to look to and to worship our Lord, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. God leads us in this time as we go through this series of restoration, of in addition to all that we're going through as a backdrop, that the Lord wants to restore our life and to be aware of that goodness that He brings into our life, even in these days. And so I trust that if this is the first time that you have found us here on the internet, that you will sense the Holy Spirit comforting you of God's love for you and His care to restore you as well. Let me invite you, if you would close your eyes, and let me open us in prayer this morning. Lord, thank you that you have come, Lord Jesus. Father, thank you for sending your Son, for giving us your Holy Spirit. And so we thank you that you are present here in our worship. And so, Lord, would you touch each heart as we come to you this morning. Affirm in us, Lord, that you have us in the palm of your hand, that you will not let go, that you are on our side to restore us and to heal us. And so we look to you in this hour. Would you be blessed, Lord, as we listen for you? And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let me invite you to stand as you may be able as I lead us in our call to worship taken from Psalm 46. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth should change, though the mountains shake in the heart of the sea. Be still and know that I am God. I am exalted among the nations. I am exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. Amen.
Good morning. Please join me in the prayer of confession based in Proverbs chapter 22, verse 1. Heavenly Father, thank you that you are faithful and true to always care. You may be trusted at all times in my life in every circumstance. Lord Jesus, you mirror our Father, and the integrity of your character is why I long to follow you. But material things capture my attention, and suddenly I find I'm caring more for these than being a reflection of you. Remind me, dear Holy Spirit, to desire the character of Jesus above all else. This I ask in His name. Amen. Here the prophet Jeremiah's joyful reminder to us that the Lord's committed care and forgiveness for his people. Hear the word of the Lord, O nations, and declare it in the coastlands far away. Say, he who scattered Israel will gather him and will keep him as a shepherd, a flock. For the Lord has ransomed Jacob and has redeemed him from hands too strong for him. In Jesus the Christ, we are forgiven. Let us take a moment and pass the peace of Christ with one another.
Thank you.
we have the opportunity to give offerings to the Lord through the week, and we're most thankful for those that have been offered. We last week had the opportunity to worship alongside the I Am Family Choir as they live streamed from Uganda. And thank you for those who were able to give to that orphanage ministry in Uganda. More locally, in these weeks ahead of us, we have the opportunity to donate school supplies. And so encourage you to see our announcement sheet that explains more about that. That is a great blessing for the children who will be distance learning as we begin this fall and as they continue through the school year. Thank you for the offerings that you give to the Lord. And so would you bow your heads with me as I give thanks to the Lord who first gives to us. Lord, you bring the sunshine upon the earth and the water. You raise the food that sustains us, Lord, so that we might be your good agents of care in this world. And so, Lord, thank you, Holy Spirit, for prompting each of us to give in the ways that you have for children, be they in Uganda, be they here in our community, for one another as we offer care for one another. Lord, would you multiply these, and would you draw attention and glory to your name, Lord, not to us, but to you, because we offer these things in the name and for the glory of Christ. And all God's people said, amen.
Our scripture reading for today is from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 8, verses 18 through 22. When Jesus saw the crowd around him, he gave orders to cross to the other side of the lake. Then a teacher of the law came to him and said, "Teacher, I will follow you wherever you go." Jesus replied, "Foxes have dens and birds have nests, but the Son of Man has no place to lay his head." Another disciple said to him, "Lord, first let me go and bury my father." But Jesus told him, "Follow me and let the dead bury their own dead." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Well, this might like an obvious statement, but only an expert can truly restore something that has been damaged to its original glory. So on the front cover of our order of service, we have that image that we're using for the service of a wonderful seating arrangement that has been worn away by life or who knows what. And we use that as an illustration of our life, that sometimes our life, we feel that we have been worn away and that we can no longer serve or be the person that God wants us to be because we've been damaged by life, by others, perhaps even by ourselves. And so only an expert can restore. So have you ever seen the difference between what an amateur can do and what a professional or an expert can do? Give you a little story. Years ago, many, many years ago, a friend of mine introduced me to one of his uncles who lived in the south of France. And this uncle drove a very expensive Maserati at the time. He showed us that in his barn, he actually invested and he bought these huge vats of cognac. And so I wondered, what did his uncle do to be able to afford such things? And so I asked him, and he explained that he restored furniture. Now, he didn't just repair furniture, but he restored very, very valuable antiques, things that were from Louis XIV, pieces that would have been in the palace, etc. And those pieces were worth thousands and thousands of dollars, as was his expertise in order to be able to restore them to their original glory. Well, as sort of a story about the same season of life, I had to restore something, and I had one of my first cars was a 1967 Camaro, and I bought it because I could afford it, but the interior was shot, the seats inside of it. And I found a catalog where you could buy these original Chevrolet seats, these two-tone vinyl covers, and I ordered these covers and I took them out of the box, and I realized as I took them out that my skills and my tools were not going to suffice, that all that I had sent possibly would be wasted away because I didn't know what I was doing. Well, I learned something at that time that I had not known before, and that was that my father, when he was younger, he worked in an upholstery shop. And so he was willing to help me, and he showed me a set of tools that he had deep in his toolbox called hog pliers. And they were perfect for restoring the inside of that 67 Camaro. And it would have been a very different outcome if I had tried to do that work as an amateur. Only an expert can truly restore something to its former glory. And so when we think about our life and the place where we feel damaged, we need to recognize that God is the expert who wants to restore and heal our life to the glory that He intends for that. Christ is our Creator. And He comes into our life just as He does in this passage that we read this morning, wanting to restore His disciples. Now, often we want to restore our own life, or we go to others that can help us restore our life. And I want to be the first to say that God can and does use others to bring healing into our life. And yet, at the same time, there are many instances when we try to heal ourselves, or we go to amateurs and look for help. And so how does God begin this work of restoration of our life to restore us to the glory He intends? It begins by having us follow Jesus. In the Scriptures, following Jesus in a committed sense is a word called discipleship. Discipleship. So our passage begins and it talks about discipleship and what it really truly looks like. The passage begins, it says, "Now when Jesus saw great crowds around Him, He gave orders to go over to the other side." He gave orders to His disciples to go over to the other side. Now Jesus saw great crowds. Crowds, the crowds are made up of people interested in Jesus for different reasons. Some came to investigate or to listen to Christ for the first time. Who is this rabbi that's teaching out in the wilderness? Some, hearing that He could heal, brought their loved ones, as we learned last week. And yet there were some others that came to spy on Jesus and to report on His activities. So not everyone in the crowd was a disciple. They were there for different reasons. But Jesus' committed followers, they were known as disciples. And so these disciples, they are learners that attach themselves to one rabbi. So this was common in the era, that there would be multiple rabbis. And so those that wanted to learn how to serve, how to know God, would attach themselves to a rabbi as their teacher. And they were called disciples. And those disciples would learn to walk in the footsteps of their teachers. And so other rabbis existed. There's a well-known one by the name of Gamaliel that's referred to in the Scriptures. And so Jesus' disciples would do that as well. They would attach themselves, commit themselves. And when they did that, they experienced a complete change of lifestyle. That is, they were willing to follow and to live and travel with their rabbi, wherever the rabbi might be based, in order to take on and duplicate the life of their teacher. And that resulted in Jesus by having an urgent an urgent, uncompromising commitment for the cause of the kingdom of God. Because that's what Jesus was all about. He said, repent and believe the good news, for the kingdom of God is at hand. And so for all of Jesus' disciples, those that would commit themselves, they knew what they were about was the kingdom of God that was breaking in even then. And so even for us today, that path of restoration for us begins by being part of the inbreaking of God's kingdom. And we learn that as we attach ourselves to Jesus, we commit ourselves to Him, to the urgency of to that, in an uncompromising way. And so that's what this passage is going to reveal to us. Now that crowd is around Jesus, and Jesus, of course, was led by the Holy Spirit, always to do the next thing. And so at this point, Jesus is led to spend time with His disciples to move away from the crowds. And so at this point, Jesus gives orders. The verse says that Jesus gave orders to go to the other side. The wording is strong, orders. And yet, Jesus again was their master, their rabbi, their teacher. And so what He said must be obeyed. Otherwise, His followers would not truly be disciples. And so they might mind, how long would Jesus have us away? Do you remember last week that we looked at Peter and his mother-in-law and his wife? And that they might have thought, oh, there goes Peter again following Jesus. A rabbi could have that authority with his disciples. He expected that obedience from his disciples because their life would become a mirror of his. So, we read in verse 19 that a scribe then approached Jesus and said, "Teacher, I will follow you wherever you go." So, as the disciples are departing and Jesus is with them, this scribe comes up to Jesus. Now, a scribe is a very specific word, and what that was in that day was it was a professional Torah scholar. So this was someone who was an expert, and his livelihood came from being a scholar, a teacher himself of the Mosaic Law. And he would have had a very specific interest in what Jesus was teaching because of Jesus' authority and his insight. And yet, because he's referred to as a scribe here, he's not yet a disciple. But he is very interested in becoming a disciple. Note that he says, "I will follow you." Not, "I have been following you," or "I am following you," but "I will follow you wherever you go." Now, in this word, wherever, the where is really important. That's where the key is in this verse here. See, this scribe, when he said wherever you go, he may have expected Jesus to have a base from which he taught all his disciples. Just like another rabbi, like Gamaliel would have had, maybe in Jerusalem. And so he may have expected, "I will go, Jesus, to where you go because I am interested in following you." Perhaps this scribe had not realized how threatening Jesus' teaching was, so that it caused Jesus to constantly have to be moving because of threats against his life. Jesus could not remain in populous areas very long, the Gospels tell us. So he was constantly on the move because his hour had not yet come. But clearly, this scribe is interested, and so now he waited to hear Jesus' response. And Jesus comes back and says, "The foxes have dens or holes, and the birds of the air have their nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head." And so Jesus was very clearly using this illustration of those animals that God loves, the foxes and the birds, that they all have a place of safety and rest that they can return to, but Jesus does not have the equivalent. And so when we read the Gospels, His disciples are always on the move with him as he goes up and down. Someone has done a study of the number of times in the Gospels that Jesus has gone from Nazareth in the north down to Jerusalem in the south. And bearing in mind that he had to walk every time, that it ended up being thousands of miles that Jesus walked in his years of his ministry. So Jesus explains to this scribe, I have nowhere, no one place. And what he implies by that to the scribe is that if you want to be my disciple, you too will have an uneasy life. It will not be easy if you want to be my disciple. See, to follow Jesus then and now, it means to hear the guidance of the Holy Spirit, to bring God's good light where there is darkness and evil. And that will not be easy. And that means that the Lord will call us to be his light in different places. So we're not told if this scribe eventually joined Jesus' band of disciples. But Jesus' statement, Matthew intended to remain there hanging for all of us even today. That if we want to follow Jesus, we cannot expect an easy, unchanging life. If we do so, we're going to regularly be irritated by God's work in this world. Because God is constantly going to be doing things around us to bring his goodness to those that are suffering. He's going to be inviting us to be part of that. And if we're not interested in that, it'll become an annoyance to us. It's not easy to be a disciple of Jesus, listening to the Holy Spirit, being ready to serve where he wants to bring his goodness and stand against evil. And so then we're given another illustration. It says that another asked Jesus, Lord, first let me go and bury my father. Now, this one is defined as a disciple. And so Matthew designates him as that because Matthew would have known that he had made a public commitment to follow Christ as the other disciples had. And now here was this disciple who had committed himself to obey everything that his master ordered him to do, and yet he was resisting that order. He said, Lord, let me first. Now, this disciple, he expresses his desire for something in priority over Jesus' command. Jesus has very clearly given them an order. Get in the boats, we're going to the other side. And yet this disciple has said, I want to do something else. And even though it begins with an expression of respect, Lord, let me, even though it's with a good desire to care for his father, that is, bury his father, and there's some evidence that that would have been a way of saying, let me care for my elderly parents, even though that honoring your parents is one of the Ten Commandments, he still resisted what Jesus was ordering him to do. Now, there are other examples in the Old Testament where the Lord directed prophets to do something by his command where they had to not obey the Mosaic law. And so this also is evidence that when the Lord speaks to us, that we are to obey what the Lord calls us to do. Because Jesus expects complete commitment from his disciples to follow his commands. Complete commitment. And so Jesus says to him, in no uncertain terms, follow me and let the dead bury their own dead. Now, Jesus was not uncaring for parents. We know how he loved his own mother. And then elsewhere in Matthew 15, Jesus accused the Pharisees of breaking the commandment of God to honor one's mother and father for the sake of their own tradition because they had their own laws. But here, the Lord is employing hyperbole to make a point about the importance of discipleship, about the importance of life and death. Because death, metaphorical death, is the condition of those that do not follow Christ completely. But life is found following Jesus and will be experienced forever following Jesus with commitment. Discipleship is critical to our life, to our salvation. A professor at Fuller Seminary by the name of Donald Hagner wrote this, that discipleship for Jesus, it's like righteousness on the Sermon on the Mount. It is an all or nothing matter. There is no in between righteousness or discipleship. We are either fully committed to it or we are not. And that's discipleship includes self-denial, service, sometimes our own suffering, sometimes persecution, in order to accomplish the good work that Jesus wants to in saving this world. And so, we have to ask ourselves, am I a disciple? When Jesus directs me, will I obey? Well, how do we know when Jesus is directing us? And of course, the foundation of our discipleship life is a life based in prayer, a regular prayer life where we pray every day and through the day, but we pray so that we learn to listen and hear. And if we do that every day at the same time in the same place, then we learn that discipline of listening to the Lord, of regularly saying, Lord, what are you asking me to do? What are you asking me to do? When Jesus calls us to obey, he can do that by those that care for us in our faith. The Lord always puts someone in our life that is more mature than we are in our faith. And we are called to follow those that can teach us in our faith. And so I have someone that I will go to and that I will ask and confirm, what is the Lord asking me to do in this situation? And we all should have that, whether it is a Bible study leader, whether it be a pastor, whether it be an elder here in the church, someone that we know that the Lord has given responsibility for our nurture, that if the Lord speaks through them, we are to trust that the Lord has faithfully spoken through them. Now, that's uncomfortable for us. I'll say that right away. It's hard for us to give up the driver's seat. We are not used to that as Americans. We are so used to the pursuit of life, liberty, and happiness on our own terms. And Jesus is saying, you will only find life if you follow me. This is a hard, hard thing for American Christians to do. And we should stand out against all of our fellow citizens when we follow Christ and we give over our life to Christ. There are times in our life where we would rather have Jesus ride shotgun while we have the keys to the driver's seat. We all know that those areas are in our life. And yet, the Lord is telling us that life, eternal life, comes with complete committed discipleship forever, forever. And so it's accepted, let me give you an example, in our culture, that organizations need to accommodate their members. Doesn't matter whatever kind of organization you are, whether you're a business, whether you're a nonprofit. And even so, some churches will have multiple worship services at times that are convenient for the church members. But if a church was called by the Lord to return to one service so that all of its members would congregate together, would all the members of the church accommodate their lives to the call of the Lord? Or would they seek another church that met their own schedule? We are such consumers as Americans. And we can treat our faith just like a product that we choose off the shelf or off of Amazon. Something that fits our lifestyle, something that tastes good to us. Jesus says, I am the master. I am the one you will follow. Listen to me. It's not easy to be a disciple. It means we have to give things up. It means we have to be willing to toss out the way we have lived in order to live a new way. And so, am I a disciple? We ask ourselves that. The Lord wants us to be healed, to be restored to the beauty and the glory of what He intended us to be. But that restoration lies on the other side of you and I being willing to let the Lord command us and to listen for that. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, You are the expert. You are our creator. You know things about us we don't even know ourselves. You know what is truly good when we are confused. And Lord, You love us and You love this world. And so, Holy Spirit, would You speak deep into our hearts so that when it is difficult for us to hand over the keys, to let You lead us in life, that we would be willing to follow. We ask this, Lord, for Your joy, for Your glory, and in Your name, Jesus. Amen.
Let us continue in prayer. O Holy One of Israel, You are the God that calms the storms. You are our rock and redeemer. You are an ever-present help in times of trouble. We lean on You and we are confident with all our hearts and minds that You are in control. We do not rely on our own understanding, but trust in Your plans for us. We turn to You and rest in You, for we already know that we are saved through our Lord Jesus Christ. We find our strength in the quietness and in the confidence of Your presence with us. We know that following You comes with a price, but we also know that You are a good, good Father, and we are so grateful that You will never forsake us. Help us, O God, to fight the good fight and to finish our race. Help us, O God, to keep our faith and stay committed to You. May our hope and trust in You be a witness to all those around us that are filled with anxiety and fear. It's so obvious that we live in a fallen world, but You are still in control. We rejoice in the absolute certainty that You have set us free and that there will be a day where there will be no more tears, no more fears, no more pain, and no more doubt. We praise You for that, O Heavenly Father. Lord, we continue to lift our country up to You. O Lord, You know the turmoil that we are in. We continue to lift our leaders up to You and pray that they will realize that they are in need of godly wisdom that can only come from a relationship with You. So many are being misled by false promises and misinformation on social media. Give us wisdom to know what is true and what is good. Father God, we lift our first responders up to You, our police officers, firefighters, doctors, and nurses, all those heroes that are committed to help even at the sacrifice of their own health and well-being. Strengthen them, encourage them, and protect them and their families. Oh God, give us wisdom to know what is best for our students studying at home or going back to school. Again, oh Father, help our leaders to know what is best. Help those that are making decisions to be led by your wisdom, not by fear. We confess that we really don't know what the answer is, but you do. So we pray that you will open the doors to the right answers. Father, so many are weary of being alone at home or constantly at home with their families. Give us hope and grace for one another and ways to cope with anxiety, weariness, and frustrations. Open our eyes to see all the blessings and joys that you provide us each day. Lord, we lift Lily Pugh up to you for strength and comfort. Be with her, O God. We continue to lift Connor and Megan up to you, that they will remain healthy and that Megan returns home safely from Florida. We thank you for Carrie Baird's surgery, and we pray for healing and that the pathology report is good news. We continue to lift Ray Holgan up to you, who is continuing with health issues. We also lift Chase up to you, and we pray that his parents can be good parents to him. You know the situation, O Lord. We continue to lift those that are hospitalized up to you, and they can't even have visitors right now. And we pray that you'll be with the loved ones that are unable to see them. We continue to lift those that are mourning up to you, those that are dealing with health issues, whether that is COVID-19 or cancer or any other health issues, Lord. We know that you are with them and that you are present in their lives. We lift Debbie, Lovey, Robin, and Harry up to you, who are in lockdown after being in contact with someone who tested positive with COVID-19. And I thank you, Lord, that they are now feeling you present and feeling more at peace, and that they're not so filled with fear anymore. Father God, now we pray together the prayer that your Son has taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
The Lord is good all the time and all the time. The Lord is good. Let me invite you to stand as I give you this closing benediction, which is also our memory verse for the week. And so may this encourage you and lead you and I this week as we trust the Lord to restore us. From Proverbs 3, 5, and 6, trust in the Lord with all your heart. Do not rely on your own insight. In all your ways, acknowledge him, and he will make straight your paths. And all God's people said, amen.